So the next speaker will be Professor Yoshinori Tokura from Tokyo University, and he's also the director of the Center for Emergence Matter Science at Riken. He's famous for his many contributions in different fields of physics, but today he will present his most recent results obtained with helical spin magnets. And
can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes, okay.
Yeah. Good. I'm just so saying that, okay. So you will show the result on, I think, a very interesting contribution showing how a very curvature-induced inductance can arise in these spinical magnets. We are listening to you.
Okay, thank you very much. And good morning, and also good evening from Tokyo. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this very wonderful conference. So today, I'd like to talk about some emergent electromagnetic phenomena, especially electromagnetic induction in the helical spin magnet. And first of all, I'd like to show the two contrasted cases of the very curvature or very phase in the momentum space and the real space. Then later I'll focus on the real space very phase and introduction to the short period helix or small skirmions in the central symmetric magnet. Then we can emphasize the amplify the topological hole and the Nernst effect of the magnetic skirmion that is a representation of the gigantic emergent magnetic field. And also we next discuss about some dynamics of these helix structures that can generate the emergent electric field. It's nothing but the origin of the electromagnetic inductions. Okay. These are my collaborators, and we are collaborating with mainly the Riken and also University of Tokyo joint group, and working with Arimura and the Nagaosa groups, and also the I just enjoyed a very close collaboration with my young professors and students. Okay. Okay. This is the two contrasting picture of the real space and momentum space very curvatures. And as you know, in the momentum space, that this kind of the very curvature, and if you integrate it over the two dimensions, and it shows the so-called Chern numbers. And it can show the quantized anomalous Hall effect depending on the Chern number of the main structures. But in the case of the real spin phase, we can define that this kind of the winding number, so-called the skirmion numbers in the real space. Then it's a quantized object is nothing but skirmions, and it can carry the quantized magnetic flux. Depending on these formulas. So actually the skirmion is the original concept but, proposed by nuclear physicist Tony Skirm, but later, maybe more than 30 years ago, Professor Bogdanov just predicts that there should be a many magnet, symmetry broken many magnet, which can host a magnetic skirmion. Actually, this was first discovered by the Christian Preiderer and the collaborators by the small angle neutron scattering, and they just observe the lattice structure of the skirmion on this kind of the chiral crystal structure, manganese silicide. Here, the spin interaction is mostly ferromagnetic, but due to the emergent symmetry breaking, there is a so-called spin anti-ferromagnetic interaction, anti-symmetric interaction called the Gerasensky-Moria interaction. So it shows usually the competition between the two terms just generates some helical spin structure like this. But you see, under the special circumstances, these three Q vectors just hybridize with each other. So these triple Q states can generate this kind of the complicated vortex lattice. And but if you scrutinize one vortex, it's nothing but a skirmion. Skirmion shows the lattice form in the triangular lattice form. And this lattice form was observed by neutron scattering. But later, to confirm the real topology of this material system, we also work on the Lorentz transmission electron microscopy, and you see the scambium phase diagram here, where we can observe the also the lattice structure, scambium crystal state. And this is a real space image of the vortex structures. And this is not the cartoon, it's a result based on the real observation, right? The black part, if you scrutinize this one scambium, and the black part is a spin moment is just along the normal direction, but it shows there are swirling vortex-like features, and finally at the core, it go down. And so the if you apply the magnetic field in this helical structure, the stripe case, then the scambium is generated, and it shows the order that in the triangular lattice, but with further increase of the temperature, the scambium tend to evaporate, but some scambium is trapped in the some trapped site. So this is image, and you see the scambium is not simply the this kind of the density wave-like state, but also the scambium just can be present as a particle natures. Okay, in this scambium, we may observe the very large emergent magnetic fields, meaning the originally that we can define the so-called scalar spin chirality. And we have three mutually canted spin structures. And then the conduction electron hopping on those local spin structures. Then they have a couple, so the underlying spin textures. Then its spin direction is forcedly aligned along the local moment direction. Then the hopping wave function, it can gain some phase factors. It's almost equivalent to part electron particle electrons moving within the magnetic field. So it effectively shows the gauge flux of an emergent magnetic field. This emergent magnetic field is in proportion to the solid angle subtended by these three spins. So the matter in the case of the scambium, this the whole entirety, this solid angle is just 4 pi. So scambium is just wrapped the spheres one time. If the spin is gathered, that's the origin. So the 4 pi by divided 4 pi is nothing but a scambium number, integer topological charge. So that means the one flux quanta is carried by the one scambium if the coupling is strong enough. So that means that if the scambium, for example, the one scambium 10 square nanometers, it's a rather dense scambium lattice, we may have, and also the strong coupling limit, we may have a emergent magnetic fields as large as 400 tesla. This emergent magnetic field just behave like a real magnetic field, but the 400 tesla is very, of course, difficult to realize in the experimental laboratories. So you want to have a very gigantic emergent magnetic field, and later also the emergent electric field, we have to have a rather short period helix or a small size scambium. So this is also may enable to observe the, some topological quantum Hall effects. Maybe on the first day, Ingrid just talked about it, right? So the in order to realize such a short period or a small size scambium, we should make use of the RKKY interaction. It's a conduction electron mediated spin coupling, and maybe the period of the helix is the order of the Fermi wave numbers. So it's usually the 1 to maybe several nanometers. So the in that case, we make use of the kind of the magnetic frustrations and using the this so-called frustrated lattice, including the triangular lattice, Kagome lattice, or in three dimension, the Kagome pyrochlore lattice. So J1, J2, J3 are competing with each other. And sometimes this magnetic frustration is, will result in the spin liquid state without any long range orders. But in other case, we have a kind of the summer period spin helix state or spin density wave state described by 2K instability. And in some understand some special conditions, this also can form the multiple queue, namely the scanning lattice. Now, actually, the recently proposed by Hayami-san or the Motome, Professor Motome, and they have a very strong scenario to observe the multiple Q states in the high symmetric lattice. In addition to the frustrated RKKY interaction, and if you have a some kind of the four-spin interaction, higher order interaction, then the, we have a very high probability to observe the scanning lattice structures. So I'm showing that this one such example, and this is the gadolinium palladium silicon intermetallic compound. And you see that this is the central symmetric lattice, but it's a triangular lattice of the Kagome local spin. Then we have a conduction electron, then the RKKY interaction sits on. So the, in that case, we always, in the magnetic ordered state, in the magnetic field and the temperature plane, ordered state, but these are all almost some helix or some density wavelength system. But its period is very short, 2.4 nanometers. So the actually the interesting order is just a minute. Interesting order is just show up relatively low field regions. One is the IC1 phase and IC2, next is the A phase, so-called the scanning lattice phase. And both are composed of the triple Q state. So the, according to the neutron scattering or some, how to say, redundant X-ray scattering, we can identify the triple Q state, but it's almost show the same result. But we assigned one state is endowed with the topological charge, scanning number one, but other state is a non-topological. This means perhaps a low state is a Meron, anti-Meron state. Maybe we don't touch on that, this detail issues. But this secondary phase is a so-called the scanning lattice, where the, we can observe the very large topological Hall effect. And this is the actual Hall effect as a function of the magnetic field. And you can see the some anomalous Hall effect in the high magnetic region, ferromagnetic regions, or also the some normal Hall effect. But only around the low field region corresponding to the, this base region, we observe the sharp peak. And this exemplified version is shown here. And we see the only A phase region, scanning lattice phase. We have a rather top flat peak is here. And its magnitude is quite large. And also when we apply the magnetic field normal to direction, and then there are, we observe almost very flat features. But when we incline the magnetic fields, then the, it's suddenly the scanning tend to disappear. And essentially the Hall effect is all essentially zero. But on the other magnetic fields, another Chan number scanning shows up and then the plus one state occurs. And this not only show the Hall effect, but also show the large Nernst effect. As you know, the Nernst effect is the we observe the transverse voltage drop when the, we have some this X direction longitudinal temperature gradient present. Then the, we observe the topological Hall effect of the scanning lattice, like here, the top flat features defined between the scanning phases. But corresponding to this one, we have a very similar one, gigantic anomalies due to the Nernst effect. So this is one of the very rare observation of the topological Nernst effect there. And if the, this Hall effect and the Nernst effect is usually connected, related with each other through the Mott relation, especially the anomalous Hall and the anomalous Nernst effect in the momentum space pictures. But then we have checked that this relation, is whether the, this relation holds also down the, this real space spin textures. And for do that, it's a modulation means that some energy derivative of the Hall effect is correspond to the some Nernst conductivity. And then the, we artificially change the band filling. It's not so usual for the, this intermetallic system, but we try to dope the silver on the palladium side, or dope the rhodium on the palladium side. It's just neighbors of the periodic tables. Then it corresponds to the electron doping and the hole doping. And as a function of this doping, we observe the rather systematic change of the topological hole effect. Very importantly, that even rather than the pure state, electron doping system, electron doped system showed even larger topological hole effect. And however, according to the band calculation, we can change that it's a chemical potential change by these doping procedures. But then we just plot the expected slope of the sigma xy in this region according to the MOT formula. And this is the experiment itself is not so easy, but showed a very, very acceptable agreement between the just a simple relation and actual observations. And that means maybe, especially the sigma xy topological is as large as a thousand. So it's a rather correspond to the almost one of the largest anomalous Nernst effects. But this is a rather topological Nernst effect. So we think that this is a kind of the indication of the description in the momentum space. If it also should be necessary for this very short period Skarmian system. Okay, so let me move on to the electric field effect, emergent electric field effect that can enable the emergent inductor or quantum inductors. And by using this kind of the very connections and the Borovic pioneer the kind of the, this new Maxwell rotation, Maxwell equations, emergent electromagnetism. And namely, as already said, the very curvature or emergent magnetic field is given by the rotation A, and this kind of the scalar spin chirality formula can give rise to the very curvature or magnetic field. And the but electric field is also derived by the time derivative of the very connection or vector potential. Then the, in that case, we'll make sure that this only that some time derivative of the moment can give rise to the electric field. But importantly, that if the skarmion is driven by some way, by some temperature gradient or electric current, then the skarmion gains some velocity. In that case, we have some, it just carries the magnetic field. So we should have some emergent electric fields. And this is a cartoon to explain this features. The skarmion carries the emergent magnetic field. So if current is flow and the electron flow is here, the electron is deflected by this emergent magnetic field. This is nothing but the topological Hall effect. But as a sort of the counteraction of the topological Hall effect, skarmion also show the another direction, the Hall effect. So this is called the skarmion Hall effect. But only the skarmion moved with a velocity of the V, then its perpendicular direction, we should have some emergent electric field. And actually this is our recent example of the tracing the motion of the single skarmions of the only 100 nanometer skarmion. And we just applied a pulse here, and then the electron is flowing from here. Electron flow is from here to here. Then usually the skarmion is expected to move along this direction, but due to this Hall effect, skarmion showed some also the transverse motion. This is nothing but the skarmion Hall effect. In reality, this skarmion Hall effect can give rise to the electric field, emergent electric field, so that this can give us some correction of the topological Hall effect. And this was very nicely demonstrated by the very macroscopic measurement by the Christian Prader and the collaborators as a correction, a change of the topological Hall effect as a function of the current densities. So the button here, the we should emphasize that this emergent electric field is not necessarily use a static Berry curvature. It's only contained at this time derivative. So in that sense, a skirmion which carries the emergent magnetic field is not necessary. So this is actually proposed by Naoto Naga authors under very simple calculations. And he said that, that maybe even in the case of the helix, the spin transfer or spin orbit torque, anyway, it can drive the spin textures, and the spin texture forms a deformation structures and by the electric current. So the this kind of time derivative and actually the spin moment is a dynamically non-coplanar state. So the in that case, emergent electric field along the Q direction or current direction is in proportion to the time derivative of the magnetic moment movement, but also the in proportion to the Q vector itself. Q vector means the inverse of the helical period. Right? So we need a really the short period helix state. So again, I show that this current induced deformation of the spin textures here. And there are the two variables. The one is that if the AC current is just tend to drive that this helix texture, it shows us some tilting structure. But on the other hand, also it shows the cause some kind of the rotations. Actually, tilting and the rotation is a rather canonical conjugate relations. So the but in the case of the rotations, if the skirmion is this helix is rather unpinned, not depinned, then the, it means that. It's kind of the translational motion of the, this phase. So the language of the spin density wave or density wave physics, it should be called a phase of excitation. So I'm sure the one examples, and this is a gadolinium lucidium aluminum compound. It's a similar to the RKKY magnet on the breathing Kagome-like lattice. And in this picture, we show the magnetic phase diagram and the in-plane direction, the magnetic fluctuation occurs. So then we have a helix state and also the magnetic fields apply along the shear axis, this direction. And then we have a transverse conical state. And then finally, the only oscillating moment, it's a so-called fan structure. And finally, it's a forcibly aligned the ferromagnetic state. But in between that, we have observed some actually skirmion state. And if we measure the, this kind of the emergent electromagnetic induction, then the, it can be measured by the imaginary part of the impedance. Because the inductance signal is this relation, as you know. So the I is since modulated, AC modulation, and then the, it's proportional to the I the 2 pi f L I. So the, this means the V divided by I, the emergent impedance shows this quantity. And here, the, for example, the, we show the magnetic field dependence also as a function of the temperatures. Right? And in this case, this is a small device structure. So the phase diagram is a little bit different, but the lowest field is the helix, skirmion, and the transverse conical, and the fan structures. So the, here the helical structure shows a rather large inductance. Skirmion is not that large, and but still finite. And the transverse conical is again large, and the fan structure is small, and also the paramagnetic state, it almost tends to disappear. Okay. And there are also it showed a very strongly nonlinear behaviors, and it's perhaps due to the nonlinear tilting or nonlinear phase of motion of the this system, right? So the very nonlinear behavior. So the problem we have to solve is the many still at present. And the one thing is, of course, it only occurred in the very low temperatures. But the problem is whether that we can increase some operating temperatures or actual tissues. So in that case, not only the purpose for the application, but also important for the fundamental issue is what is the effect of the thermal agitation or fluctuation of the disk spin system to the this emergent electric field generations. So in that, for that purpose, we search for the rather higher TC materials. Again, we make use of the Kagome lattice state. But this one is a gadolinium moment and the conduction electron, their role is quite distinct. And but we can use some the manganese 3D element making the Kagome lattice. Recently, this compound is also become very famous. Many people are working on that. And actually, the interesting, it shows the magnetic modulation this along the C axis. But still, the, even in that case, rather short period screw state is observed. And again, there, if we apply the magnetic field in plane, this C axis magnetic modulation is again the helical, transverse, conical, and the fan state and the ferromagnetic state. And it's very bear the close analogies, although the crystal structure and the Q modulation direction is totally different. And even more important is the TC, the order of magnitude change. But still, like this compound, we have a similar helix, transverse, conical, the magnetic fields apply this direction. Then this cycloidal plane turned over with a transverse conical state, and then the fan state. Then we also observe the this imaginary part of the impedance. Okay. And in that case, maybe in this current density, it's not that large as compared with the spintronic use, but we show the helical region is a rather negative region, and the transverse core, so they're also negative, but near the boundary, it's become positive. And we just plot the contrast plot of the inductance signal magnitude. And mostly the helical region, transverse conical helical region show the large signals, and mostly it's negative, but at only high temperatures, it turns to the positive. But if we scrutinize the very low current regions, then the mostly the this region is a negative, but we observe the always the positive signals. Although the this current is only 1/4, I don't know, maybe 1/8 of the current density, but the signal itself is much smaller. But important is the low current density, the inductance is always positive. So the at fixed temperature and the changing the current density, and we just scan the magnetic fields, helix, transverse conical, and the ferromagnetic state. And then the ferromagnetic state is eventually the signal is zero as expected, but originally the, it's minus signals, and but when the current is not so small, then the, it's turned to the positive region, and this positive, negative to positive change is a change as a function of the current density. And depending on the magnetic field regions, this shows the minus to positive change. This quite looks quite puzzling, but we, for example, the taking example of the 2.5 Tesla data at this point, then there we see that this actual inductance value is very small positive and very largely negative, then the turn to the largely positive region. And the small, this region is always positive, remains positive. Why such a non-trivial issue occurs in the inductance as a function of the current density excitation? So the, maybe we come to the tentative conclusions to explain this phenomenon, and it's mostly from the recently reported theories by Klevash and Narosa. And we have two deformation of the spin. One is a kind of this tilting, right? Spin is just rotating this way. The other is a kind of the spin rotation. It causes some translational of the helix. So it's Faison degrees. So this is a tilting deformation always give rise to the positive inductors. But Faison relaxation, Faison excitation is that it, of course, it shows us some pinning frequency or some energy gap here. So it's a pinning frequency. It depends on the pinning frequency. If the observation frequency is much lower than the pinning frequency, then there are, according to the resonance structures, the inductance signal become negative. But observation is higher, or pinning is a very depending frequency. The pinning frequency is very lower. Then we have a positive inductance. So the inductance signal can be both positive or negative. And maybe intuitively, maybe you can see the disk graph. The tilting is all as a function of the omega, it's almost constant one until the very high frequency. But in the Faison signal, it shows us some resonance structures as a function of this pinning frequencies. So the pinning frequency is high enough, then it's only positive. But pinning frequency is close to the observation frequency, and then it shows the directly feel the Faison contribution become negative. But with further pinning frequency lowered, then it shows the positive contributions. This might explain that this kind of the reentrant plus minus plus future, and these regions can be interpreted. It is mostly affected this Faison excitations in the distance wave state. And we think a J increase effectively promotes a depinning of the this helix state. So the omega pinning is just 10 to decrease with increase of the J. And this is also that not only the temperature magnetic field dependence, but also the shows some direct measurement using the LCR methods. And you see this is inductance value itself. And at high temperature region is a positive, and the low temperature region is largely negative, but this value is rather large. And for example, let me compare here the conventional inductors and also the quantum inductors. And in the usually the inductor, in the classical inductor is composed of the inductor coil, and the inductor coil L is in proportion to the square of the winding number and cross-section. Cross-section means that this coil cross-section. So that is the reason why we cannot miniaturize the inductor coil. And in your PC and in your portable phone, you have a lot of this coil. That is the reason why you cannot have a very mini PC, mini one. And the S is necessary. But on the contrary, our quantum inductors, emergent inductor, is make use of this kind of the Heli magnet. We can miniaturize the samples. And also that it may show the sometimes, it's a very non-linear, but it's very problem, but it shows a very large value sometimes. So the very short. And it's also inversely proportional to the winding, namely the helix pitch, but also inversely in proportion to the cross-section. It simply depends on the, let's say, the current density itself. So we think optimistically that we can miniaturize our inductor coil 5 over 6 order magnitudes smaller than the ever classic inductors. So the issue to be solved is still many, and one thing is just a very Debye-like features of this inductor, and the high frequency response is very bad. Sometimes it's 10 to up to the 10 kilohertz, but still they are less than 100 kilohertz. So it's very bad. So we don't know what is the origin, but it's perhaps a Faison depinning is also the source of this one. So maybe these all nonlinear or the sign change or the Debye-like relaxation all relate to the Faison dynamics or Faison pinning depinning process. And the next one is maybe we just work on the screws, but also the
sorry, side. We are running a bit out of time, so.
Yeah, okay, this is the final. Right, and the cycloid features. So this spin transfer torque or spin orbit torque is also at work. So I guess that maybe by using the cycloidal features, that we may extend this emergent electromagnetic induction phenomena to other material or device structures, including the spin orbit torque on the magnetic topological insulators. We already observed this one. And also the heavy metal and magnet spintronics bilayer combination. And there be many promising material or device structure should be there. Okay, I'll just give my conclusion. And we just realized that topological hole and the nearest effect in the rather very large effect in the very small size scavenging state realized by the RKKY interaction. And also the using such materials, we just observed the emergent electromagnetic induction in chiral magnet. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Tukua, for this very nice presentation. So the session now is open for discussion. We already have one question on the chat from Danila Amoro. Can you hear me? Because apparently I have some problem with my microphone. So maybe we can unmute the microphone from Danila, and you could ask, please, your question directly. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I can read it. Danila?
Can you read it? Yes.
Danila, you can speak? Yeah, no.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Okay, so otherwise, I will read it.
Yeah.
So a rather general and basic question. How is the polarity defined for high Q stereomonic objects like for a biskermion, considering that those are composed by multiple centers?
Can you repeat the question? Polarity?
How is the polarity defined for high Q stereomonic objects like, for instance, a biskermion, considering that they are composed by multiple centers?
I'm not talking about the biskermion, right? I don't understand the question.
It was a question about clusters of kermions. So maybe she will manage to use the microphone like me.
Maybe if I can
ask maybe also a basic question. In this model, is it important that adiabatic transport of spin is considered? Because you are considering, because of course to have a large inductance, you need to have a short magnetic period. And therefore, is this adiabatic condition for spin transport realized for ultra short magnetic textures?
So actually, I don't understand quite well. And actually, I think some kind of the spin torque is coming from the usually the spin transfer torque or spin orbit torque. But there is almost, I think, under the strong short period helix system, the no distinction between these two torques, I believe.
If it's very short time length scale, then it means that the electron spin, they cannot really follow the evolution at equilibrium. So that was my question.
If this
has an impact on the result, or if it's having adiabatic or non-adiabatic transport is not important for the result.
Actually, I don't know the answers, but actually that maybe this damping we observed is a very low frequency region. So it's not directly just a kind of the original spin damping. And I think it's rather due to related to the collective motion of the phason or spin density wave. So it can be very, originally the phason mode is Gorson modes. So the very low frequency pinning is okay.
We have another question from Juan Tierra. Can you turn on, unmute your microphone, please? Thanks.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for the presentation. So I have two questions regarding the topological Nernst effect. So the first one is, what is the temperature gradients that you can build up in your samples?
The temperature region for
you need a temperature gradient to measure this Nernst effect. So what are the temperature gradients that you build up in your system?
I don't remember, but I think that for the low temperature system, I think it's low enough, I guess.
Okay, yeah. And then a more basic question is, how this topological Nernst effect, the magnitude of this effect, compares to the Nernst effect in conventional ferromagnets?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, and it's a rather correspond to the family of the largest Nernst effect compound. So for example, the topological Hall effect itself is almost thousand. So it's almost a limit of the intrinsic anomalous Hall effect. So I think the Nernst effect is also the as large as some of the maximum group magnet group, which showed a large. Very large anomalous Nernst effect. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. That is the reason why I just emphasize that this result, maybe we just use some discussion based on the real space pictures. But in reality, if the magnetic texture becomes so small, so uh-huh. In that case, we have to move to the maybe k-space pictures. But still, it's not theoretically, it's not so easy. Maybe the many folding occurs in the Moriland zones. And so I think it's very difficult issue. But maybe case-based picture might be better.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let me thank you, Professor Tokoa, for this very interesting presentation. To all participants, you know that you can meet our speakers in these meeting rooms. You have the link in the chat. So I invite you to leave this session now and join the meeting room if you want to further discuss with our speakers.
Okay, I can just
after the coffee course. You have also to leave this one and to go to the other one.